I was lucky enough to be part of this New Zealand men's Kiwi 8. And today I'm here to basically tell you the story. It's a bloody wild story that I love telling. I've learned a lot. This has been my life for the last decade. And so this has really defined who I am. And contrary to what you would believe, seeing me standing there with a gold medal with my teammates, this story is definitely not about winning gold. This story is more about all of the failures that made us worthy of being able to win gold. And so to give you a little bit of context around this whole project of the New Zealand Men's 8 and trying to get this Olympic gold, we have to take you back basically to 1972. Now, this is a historic moment in New Zealand sport. This is when the New Zealand Men's 8 won the Olympics in 1972 on a course in Munich, Germany. This is a historic hero level crew, and since then no other New Zealand men's eight has been able to replicate or even get close to what they achieved. And in 2013 the project started to try and replicate what this 1972 eight did, and so it got broken down into a four-step plan. And so 2013 was when we started, and an athlete's life is in four-year cycles, a Olympic athlete life. So between Olympics. So we started in 2013, that's step one, 2014, step two, 2015, step three, 2016 being the finale, was meant to be the Rio Olympics, where we were going to recreate history and do what the 1972 eight did. And so step one and two was under 23 world champs. We put together this young, hot-headed, arrogant little crew, and we managed to win twice at under 23 world champs. So step one and two were paved with gold. We had come in hot and we had come away with two medals at under 23 level. And I look back at these photos and I look how chummy we looked and how excited we looked that we were going to take on the world, and had no idea what we were in, what we were basically in for. And so, what did this do for a group of, you know, hot-headed young 20-year-olds? As I said, it made us super arrogant. And it made us a little bit disillusioned about how easy this path was going to be. The next year, step three, we stepped up to the elite category, 2015. And so this is a really important year, our first time in the big leagues at the Olympic level of the sport. And again, we had won 2 years in a row. We thought we were going to come in 2015 and we were going to medal at least. This year, we ended up with a fourth, so a slide backwards a little bit. What that fourth place did was qualify us for the Rio Olympics, crucially. That was the goal. So we were now qualified. There was going to be a New Zealand men's eight at the Rio Olympics. But we were disappointed. We had slid back. We had won twice, and then we had come fourth. And so we were out to make an improvement. And step four, the finale of what we thought, Rio Olympics. This is where we were going to do it. This is where we were going to recreate the 1972 eight's historic win. And win at the Olympic Games for the first time in 46 or 45 years. That's everything we had built for. I've basically skipped over 4 years of my life, but everything that we were working towards, everything that we could possibly do, we had poured into this campaign over these 4 years to give us the best shot at winning the Olympic gold at Rio 2016. And we came sixth. So we came last in the A final. And I've coloured it like this because it was a sickly performance. It was disgusting. We were horrified that we had won 2 years in a row. We had slipped back to fourth, but we were still in the mix. And then all of a sudden, we were last in the A final. We'd come sixth. And so we had to rebuild. We had to start again. 2017 rolled around and the New Zealand Men's 8 was back on the water. Our original four-step plan had become an eight-step plan. As I said, we work in four-year cycles as elite athletes, as Olympic athletes. And so we had to move the goalposts 4 years further back. And I mean, that's a huge undertaking, realizing, right, I've got another 4 years to work towards this thing. And so step five became the 2017 Elite World Champs. And so, can everyone see over this side? Sorry if I'm blocking your way. 2017 became the Elite World Champs. And crucially, This was the start of the new cycle, and all we wanted to do was to show improvement. We knew that previously, last year, we were sixth in the world. We needed to show a little bit of momentum that we could actually, to give us a bit of confidence that we could actually achieve an Olympic gold. Sixth. Again, that same color, that horrible color. And so if I map out our performance over my first years in the sport, it's pretty grim. It's pretty grim. Yeah, it's a... Yeah, I mean, this is, unfortunately, might be a familiar sight in current economic conditions, but that is where we found ourselves. And that's not very inspiring for, you know, Rowing New Zealand to back this crew, because it is it comes down to money a lot of the times, where it's expensive to send an eight over the other side of the world in all these overseas races. Some of that comes from taxpayer money, some of that comes from, you know, philanthropic donors, but we weren't giving them a very good reason to back us. And so 2018 rolled around, and this became such an important year. We were halfway through this next Olympic cycle. Step six was the 2018 Elite World Championships. Now, like I said previously, all we wanted out of this 2018 World Championships was to show a sliver of improvement, to show something. We had come sixth for the last 2 years. The goal was a modest fifth, just to finish fifth. We must show improvement. That was the theme of this year. That was what was drilled into us from Rowan New Zealand and ourselves. We knew that we needed this. 12th. So we had gone from losing in the A final to losing in the B final, coming dead last. Yeah, big loser, big time loser. And I've made this text tiny. Because that's how small we felt coming last in the B final. I felt so insignificant, and so much of my life had gone into this bloody sport, and that's what I had to show for it. And so, big old quit off. Yeah, obviously, it's absolutely dead last in the world. So, yeah, you're racing at an elite level, representing your country, and you come dead last, so it's embarrassing. And so this graph I showed you before all of a sudden looks a hell of a lot more bleak when you look at it like that. So that is a true representation of the trending graph of the New Zealand men's eight. And at this point, we're in 2018. It's not long until the Tokyo Olympics. And so at this point, I'm trying to work out what I should do next, whether this is actually the sport for me, whether I should quit, because, I mean, I've poured in 6 or 7 years at the top level of my everything of myself into the sport, and I have nothing to show from it apart from diminishing returns, diminishing results. And so, yeah, it became this question here: should I quit? Like, that was probably one of the lowest I've ever been in my life, trying to work out whether everything was for naught. And as I was thinking about that, 2019 rolled around. Now, 2019 was a little bit different. We had an injection into the New Zealand men's eight of a couple of legends who showed a little bit of faith in the program. So on the far side there, we've got Mahi Drysdale, who was a two-time Olympic champion in the men's single. And on this side, on your right, I have Hamish Bond, who also is a two-time Olympic champion as part of the New Zealand men's pair. Now, these guys coming into the crew signaled a bit of a change at Rowan New Zealand. All of a sudden, we were putting more of our eggs into this basket, into the men's eight. And we had some guys who had some real success who knew how to win coming into this eight. And so we're like, holy shit, here we go. Things are going to change for us. And so step seven became the 2019 Elite World Champs. Now, I found myself sandwiched between my two heroes of the sport. So we've got Mahi Drysdale on the far side and Hamish Bond on this side, and myself looking like I'm smiling in the middle. And I can tell you that is not a smile, because this eight was as much a dumpster fire as it was every other year. You see, we thought that these guys were going to come into the crew. They've won Olympic gold medals themselves in a single and a pair. And that is like comparing, a good comparison is comparing rugby 15s versus rugby 7s. It is a completely different sport. There is so much learning that goes into it, into transferring from one sport to another. That's what it's like rowing a pair or a single to jumping in the eight. It is totally different. It is a totally different sport. And so obviously, Hamish and Mahi have very set in stone beliefs about how to make a boat go fast. And they were often at odds with one another. So I found myself sitting between them and often having to break up fights between these two heroes of the sport. So we're sitting in the middle of an Italian lake on a training camp. I've got Mahi in front of me, Hamish behind me, and both of them are bitching at each other like school kids. Hamish is calling Mahi fat, and Mahi is saying that Hamish has no idea how to move a boat. And I'm like, what the fuck is going on? These are my childhood heroes, and all of a sudden I'm having to go shut the fuck up and let us row. And so this eight was a dumpster fire. We had more firepower, we had more of the right bits, but we couldn't get alignment. We didn't know actually how to make an eight go from A to B as fast as possible. But we were in crunch time. 2019 is an essential year. So 2019 is the year before the Olympics, and in Olympic sport you have a chance to qualify for the Olympics that year. At the Olympics, in a men's eight, there can only be seven crews. So there are seven crews to qualify. At the 2019 World Champs, five of those crews get decided. So the top five places at 2019 book their spot for the Olympics. So it's cutthroat. There's a lot more, there's many more crews out there than just seven, and so a lot of people miss out. And so the 29 World Champs, this was the task. Top five. Top five, no exceptions. Because that's five of the seven spots at the Olympics booked. That was the goal. And in previous cycle, at the Rio Olympic cycle, we had finished fourth in 2015 qualifying the boat. So we knew we were good enough to do it, even though the year before we had come 12th. And we had better people in the crew. So top five. It was everything. Top five. So that was sixth. And that's what it looks like. That's what failure looks like. I'm sitting with two of the guys that I have grown up watching, and we have all failed together. We have failed to qualify for the Olympics. And as far as we were concerned, that was it. That was the dream over. I mean, I showed you this graph before. I know we finished sixth, but it's as good as an atomic bomb in terms of what actually happened. Like, that meant the New Zealand men's eight was not going to be at the Olympics. And so, what now? It's another point in my rowing career where I wondered, what the hell am I doing with my life? I've put so much into this. All my friends and family are progressing with their lives, and everyone's got careers, and I'm just a failing rower at this point. And so, the four-step plan became the eight-step plan, became the nine-step plan with massive question marks beside it. Because you know how I mentioned there was seven crews that qualify for the Olympics, five of which get qualified at the 2019 World Champs, the year before the Olympics, and another two get qualified at what is called the Regatta of Death. So this is in 2020, 6 weeks before the Olympics in Switzerland. It's called the Last Chance Qualifying Regatta, but for every athlete, it is the Regatta of Death. It's basically where Olympic dreams go to die. At that regatta, it is 10% of the athletes at that regatta qualify for the Olympics, the rest don't. And that's the reason why they are there, is to qualify for the Olympics. So you see this huge range of emotion from people who have made their dream come true to people that have totally failed. And so Rowing New Zealand has no history of sending crews to this regatta. It is such a big risk, and we have to fly athletes from New Zealand all the way to Switzerland 6 weeks before the Olympics, and then fly them back to New Zealand, and then fly them to Tokyo. Like, it's a crazy expense. And so this was, I mean, I've put in a small question mark there, but this is a massive question mark as to whether this step eight would even happen, whether Rowing New Zealand would put their faith in us again. And then came COVID. So we didn't even get to think about that decision because 2020 became the year of COVID. And so my life was this. I mean, this was the noise I was familiar with. This was the feeling I was familiar with. Working with your teammates, focusing on these small little gains. There's something quite relaxing about this. My world became this. In a crowded garage that leaked in the middle of winter, training my heart out. This is my four walls. So rowing machine, a stretching mat, some weights, a bench, and a dog. That was me for an entire year. And to put some perspective as to how humbling this was, we were training our hearts out for the possibility of an Olympic Games that may or may not happen in a boat class that we weren't even qualified for. It felt ridiculous. It was such a strange place to be. And again, another situation where I thought, maybe the best option here is quitting, because everything is stacked against us. Everything. And throughout this time, something strange happened that I did not expect. We had a batch of young guys come through the team. So Matt McDonald, top left, Tom McIntosh, top right, Phil Wilson, bottom left, Dan Williamson, bottom right. Now these guys actually benefited from having another year. They're all early 20s. They're young whippersnappers, young talented whippersnappers. But they saw the fact that the potential, the Olympics had been pushed out 1 year because of COVID as a huge opportunity to get better. And that's what they bloody well did. So these young guys really did lead the charge, and they had this fresh enthusiasm for what we were working towards. And so it was at this point that I realized that the New Zealand men's eight had suffered from two diseases. The obvious one is COVID. Everyone suffered from COVID. But the other, less obvious, more sneaky, more under the radar, was our toxic team culture that had got us to the position we were at. And so I had this unique vantage where I had been in the New Zealand men's eight every single year. I'm the only athlete that was in it from 2013 through to 2021. I was in it every single year. Nobody else was in it every single year. And with that perspective, I saw this sneaking little second disease, which was a cancerous culture. You see, we unwittingly had built this culture of, you know, finger pointing, of excuse making and complaining. It had snuck in so quietly that we hadn't even realized that it had happened until these young guys started coming through the team with a fresh set of eyes that could look at this team culture and recognize it straight away. And it summed up really well with the conversation I had with Tom McIntosh. So this is some photos of our recent trip that Tom and I have done back to Japan. That's a whole nother story. But Tom McIntosh, first year in the Olympic team. And we're in a position, just to take your memory back, we had just come out of COVID, and like a lot of New Zealanders, we were craving a bit of social interaction. And so what we did is we had a big piss up, basically. We had just come out of lockdown and we had a barbecue and we just got on the beers and reconnected with all our teammates, because that's what we desperately needed. And Tom McIntosh, with youthful enthusiasm and extreme confidence because of how drunk he was, came up to my shoulder. And as you can see, Tom is a big guy. He's really, really tall. And you can imagine him pressing his hand down on my shoulder and screaming in my ear. And what he was doing was basically telling us all the ways that the men's eight had failed, all the reasons why the men's eight had failed. Now, I'm a seasoned veteran in this crew at this point. I've been in it for 8 years, and I've got some young bastard coming over, putting all his weight on my shoulder, sort of using me for balance, and screaming in my ear about all the things that we've done wrong. And my initial gut reaction, as you'd expect, was, fuck this guy. Who does he think he is? And it's his first year in the team. And I talked about COVID being the great humbler. Like, that was the massive reset for this crew. And I realized as Tom was saying what he was saying to me, I had this initial gut reaction to be really against it. And then all of a sudden I realized, like, what do I know better? How do I know anything more than this kid? I think that everything he is saying is 100% right. And I realized that I was letting my ego get in the way of it because I had invested more time than Tom had. So Tom said two things to me. What in his drunken confidence, he's a very articulate guy, he uses creative words. The first word he used was transcend. Now these two words that I'm about to talk to you about became Tom and I's mantra, basically, our mantra. Everyone has different, in the eight, everyone had different words to describe how we built what we did. For Tom and I, the first was transcend. And we defined transcend as the idea that, because, I mean, you look at that word and you're like, what the hell does that have to do with rowing and sport? But transcend for us meant that if there was anything that we could do that gave us a small percentage chance of a better result, we would do it without question. And we would aim for without complaining. That's really hard to do when you're trying to do all those little 1%ers to not complain, but that was the goal. And so what that looked like is if we thought we would benefit from more training, some extra kilometers on the water, we would do it. If we could benefit from more flexibility training, sleep training, mindfulness training, if we could benefit from more nutrition training, anything, heat acclimation training, everything. Everything to make sure that we gave ourselves the best chance of performing well. We talked about transcend, that was the mindset, but what we were doing was stacking the odds that we would perform well. You're giving yourself every opportunity to perform well. So I loved that. I loved the idea of that because that meant that all of a sudden Tom and I were doing extra and it felt exciting because you're doing it with somebody else. And that leads on perfectly to critical mass. The other word that he was screaming in my ear with drunken confidence. Now, critical mass is the idea that if we get enough people operating the same way, it becomes like gravity. So Tom and I started talking about transcend, and other people wanted to join in, and they saw us doing extra, and all of a sudden, we started to create what we call critical mass. And it's like gravity, so that's why I've drawn these little pretty circles. So if you get enough people operating like that, you draw more people in. It's exponential. And then it becomes actually hard to resist that. It's a counterintuitive because we were working harder, but it was more fun because more people were getting involved. And as we worked harder and had more people involved, anyone who resisted was spat off into no man's land, just like gravity. They were ejected from orbit. And so what this did, and you know, everyone in the eight has different ways of describing how this happened. This is Tom and I, how we described it. But what this did is it got eight people on the same page for the first time in this entire campaign. And so like a phoenix, the eight rose from the ashes after all this failure, a completely different team, completely different from the ground up. And now's a really good time to mention the guy in the foreground there, Hamish Bond, and the guy in the background with the beanie, Tony O'Connor. These Tony, our coach, and Hamish Bond, who Hamish is instrumental in the eight remaining a thing in Rowing New Zealand and being a driving force with the Rowing New Zealand selectors, with everyone, the sponsors, to make this thing real, and Tony for guiding us. I don't have enough time to actually pay them proper recognition, so I'm not even going to get into it because I'll do them a disservice. But I just want to mention that this story is a lot of our results were because of these guys as well. But back onto the New Zealand Men's Eight. And so this is what the new New Zealand Men's Eight looked like. And to give you an idea of how much we trusted these young athletes, in a rowing boat, you have everyone facing backwards. On your left, you have your stroke man, 7-seat, 6-seat, 5-seat, 4-seat, 3-seat, and bow seat, which is 1-seat. And so we're following, you can see where I am, the token ginger in the boat, we are following what we call the stern four, which is the four guys to the left here. And those are the four young guys that I talked about earlier. The four young guys who came in with a fresh perspective. And we had enough confidence that we would put them in the stern of the boat to lead us. And then we've got the old guard in the back of the boat. So Michael Brake, myself, Hamish Bond, and Tom Murray. The order eventually switched around, but this is how we originally seated it because of how much trust we had in these young guys. And so, a crazy turn of events, and step eight, because of all the momentum we started showing in this New Zealand Men's Eight, all of a sudden we were going to the Regatta of Death in 2021. So Rowing New Zealand had given us the all clear. This was huge. This meant that the dream was still alive. There was a sliver of hope. But we knew it was a really small sliver. We were traveling 6 weeks before the Olympics to Switzerland, then coming back to New Zealand, and then going to Tokyo. It's not ideal. An athlete's life is very focused and very all these controllables, and everything is trying to get you the best performance possible. You add in long-haul flights. You add in some international racing, which you actually have to taper your training for so you can perform at your best. That is not ideal. And added on top of that, we had the challenge of being the first New Zealanders, some of the first New Zealanders to get the COVID vaccine. We had no idea what would happen. We got early COVID vaccines. And we were some of the first New Zealanders to leave New Zealand during a pandemic. It was wild. We had four cases in New Zealand at the time, four cases of COVID. And we were traveling into Switzerland where they were living like we are now. They were living with COVID. So their sort of their rules and regulations around it were super, super lax. And to paint a clear picture of how much of a challenge this was, is there was no game plan, there was no way of getting us home if one of us got sick. And so it felt like a crazy risk, and looking back on it, I can't believe we got sent to this regatta because of everything that could have gone wrong. But we had built a team that was a little bit different. Everyone was operating on this transcend sort of mindset. And what this meant is that the eight became a moving, rolling sanitation team. So anywhere we went, every surface that could potentially be touched was doused in half a liter of hand sanitizer. And everyone that could potentially have COVID was kept at 4 meter distance. And anytime you could wear two or three masks, you would. It was a crazy militant-like approach to not getting sick, because we had to, because so much was riding on this, so many eggs were in this basket. So we traveled to Switzerland. Last chance we get it. It's for everyone who hasn't qualified for the Olympics. And so, a crazy intense regatta. We came up against the Romanians, who were also trying to qualify, and a few other crews. Now, getting to this regatta was less about whether we were fast enough to qualify. It was more about whether we could do it and not get COVID. That was the challenge. So this is a shot of the final. We managed to stay in front of the Romanians and win this regatta to finally book our place at the Olympics. After everything we went through, this felt like the dream come true. We were finally going to the Olympics. Our tickets were booked. The Tokyo Olympics were happening in 2021, yes, one year later, but it was happening. We were finally going. But first, MIQ. So, I mean, we forget that this was a thing, but when we came back, we were some of the first to leave the country, and as a result, some of the first to come back as they were trialing and working out how the MIQ system worked. So we had to spend 2 weeks in a hotel room in Christchurch. And like I said, we had 6 weeks until the Olympics. So 33% of that time was spent on a rowing machine in a hotel room. Now imagine what it's like for our neighbors hearing eight of these machines going for 4 hours a day, every single day for 2 weeks. So this became our life. And in that time, we rode 400 kilometers in 13 days on the rowing machine. So I encourage you to jump on a rowing machine just to get some perspective of how ridiculous that was and how much training we were actually doing. And I think somebody who sums it up perfectly and in a really eloquent way of actually how hard that was Dan Williamson, our youngest guy on the team. And so this is how we operated in that time. We loaded up everyone on Zoom screens so we could see the mutual struggle. There's something really powerful in that. When you're struggling, but you are struggling together, that is really powerful. And so although this is grim, and Tony, our coach, is sitting there sipping his tea and filming Dan and having a great old time, this was fantastic motivation knowing that everyone else in the crew was going through the same hard training. Everyone else was covering 400 kilometers in 13 days. And it's like we hadn't skipped the beat. We got back on the water and we started putting the finishing touches on the New Zealand men's eight. Might have some issues playing this video because of the Wi-Fi. But at this point, we had 4 weeks until the Tokyo Olympics, and we were back on the water finally, making everything as polished and perfect as we possibly can. So step 9, the Tokyo Olympics. We're finally here, 2021. This is a photo I took from the Olympic Village, and it is a truly overwhelming thing to be at the Olympic Village. You are side by side with the best athletes in the world, and you're all in the same place. So this is what it looked like. All these high rises were filled with athletes, and this is one of the central roads which showed all the flags of every country competing. It was amazing. I've been to 2 Olympics, and each time it has been so incredibly overwhelming. But it is a massive distraction from what you're trying to do, the Olympic Village. I mean, this was our apartment building where the New Zealand team was staying. This is my view from my hotel. I was looking down at the best athletes in the world and down at the food hall, and everything was screaming, this is a distraction. It's often something that is talked about where a young athlete goes to his first Olympics and is overwhelmed by the whole environment, the whole situation, and it's almost like performance is second. Performance is not the priority. I recognized that I was getting overwhelmed, but with the wisdom of having my second Olympics or having an Olympics under my belt, I realized that we needed to be super focused to not get overwhelmed. So we lined up to the heat, the first race of our Olympic campaign in Tokyo. And I spoke about how the atmosphere of the Olympics can really get to you. I mean, I've worked for 8 years of my life, 9 years of my life to get to that start line. And for half the crew, this is their first Olympics. So they're all young guys, first Olympics. We had spoken about not being distracted, not being overwhelmed by what we were doing and where we were and everything that had gone into this and everyone that was watching and all the pressure we had put on ourselves. We had talked about this time and time again. But in the heat, it showed a few little cracks in our armor. So the men's eight was building this crazy momentum. We were doing some seriously quick times. We knew we were going faster than any other New Zealand eight had gone in the past. So we lined up to the heat with a bit of confidence. Now the heat at the Olympics, we had to finish first to qualify for the A final. If we finished any place other than first, we had to go through a repechage, which is essentially sort of like a semi-final. And so the goal was to finish first. We knew we'd have another chance to make the A final, but you know, you want to start off on the right foot, win your first race. We ended up finishing second behind the Dutch by half a length. And so we realized that we were going to have to do another race. And previously, in previous years, we would have all this expectation, thinking we were going to get this sort of performance. And with our toxic culture, I would have seen an eight all put their heads down after, you know, underperforming. Everyone would have started pointing fingers, everyone would have started making excuses, but in this eight, I saw something completely different. We came off the water with everyone's head held high, realizing, shit, if we're that close, rowing like crap, how close are we gonna be if we actually get this right? And so, 2 days later, after regrouping, after focusing, making things simple again on what we have to do, not getting overwhelmed. We had had our first little fluffy race where we hadn't got grip. We were like a high-powered car not getting the traction down to the road. We had taken all these learnings into the repercharge. Now, repercharge, we had to finish top 4 to make it into the A final. The goal was to win. And this is a strange situation, being at the Olympics, pinnacle event of your life, all this training has gone into it, and you race this race and it feels easy. It feels easy. And I don't say that lightly. This is the last few strokes of this race, controlling it in front of everyone else. 5:21 is the fastest time a New Zealand eight has ever gone. And it felt easy. It felt like we were operating at 90%. It's also 2 seconds off the world record. And it was sort of really jobbly conditions. And straight after the race, we rode off until our warm down, and I had a look and looked at this British crew in a pile, in a heap after that repercharge, their current Olympic champions. And so we rode off into our warm down straight away. I heard a call from one of the guys in the back just saying, straight into warm down. And so everyone automatically straight into our warm down, not stopping. You're resisting the urge to stop because we are really tired, but that mind game was crucial. Looking across and seeing, especially that guy on the far left in the yellow boat, in a heap across the finish line, making a whole bunch of noise, and we're already into our warm down. That was a power play. And so we lined up for the final 2 days later. And it's a strange time in an athlete's life. You're just waiting for this damn final. And I couldn't imagine life after that final. But the Repercharge had given us a huge amount of confidence that if we just rode the way we had practiced, with the trust we had in our crew, and with this team we had built over through all of these failures, that we might be able to do something pretty special. And again, it felt like a best kept secret. We hadn't really told anyone how fast we were going. We had shown the first real glimpse of our ability to perform in that Repercharge. And then we lined up at the Olympic final.
New Zealand won one of the two qualification spots. I suppose they'll be outsiders in this Olympic final, but you never know. They had a stunning gold all the way back in Munich in 72. So away we go then in the men's eight final, the last race at the Olympic Rowing Regatta at Tokyo 2020. It's a nice flat start there. Who's got the edge? Is that the Germans?
Yeah. I think the Germans are out quick. They have a 2 or 3 meter lead over the British. Kiwis moving fast. Look at the Kiwis to the left of the Germans, that green boat, the all-black boat, the Kiwis number two. Where have they got their boat speed from? They're right up on the quickest on the course at the moment, 22.7 kilometers an hour. The Germans at 22 kilometers an hour. Netherlands at 22.7, and the Kiwis going to hit the front. They hit the front now. They've got a great third quarter as well, and the Germans will have to now dig in to hold them off. Wow, what a race from New Zealand. Did you see the way they moved back on the Germans there? Sensational coming through. Will the disappointing regatta for the British be about to end? Will they break Kiwi hearts in this third quarter? Look at the Kiwis, Andy. Look at them go. Wow, that is amazing. They've just taken a third of a length off the British, like the British are standing still. Germany can't go with them. Kiwis showing their traditional fast third quarter.
Where have New Zealand found this pace? At the 1500 metre mark, it's New Zealand from Great Britain by the looks of things. New Zealand have turned on the afterburners.
There's Hamish Bond going down the boat for New Zealand. What a crew this is. Got the 22-year-old Matt McDonald in the stroke seat. Big call from Tony O'Connor to put the North Shore oarsman in the stroke seat, but he's showing back. But Britain are coming now. Again on New Zealand, where have they found that pace from? Kiwis have still got around about, what, 3/4 of a second lead. Hamish Bond digging in, showing all the form to took into the two Olympic gold medals. Kiwis are stretching out. It's going to be New Zealand's gold to lose. 1972 on the Munich course when the Kiwis last won Olympic gold in the men's eights. This is going to ride that story large again.
And their third gold medal in the rowing. First for the men here at Tokyo 2020. It's the Kiwis coming up to the line.
Arms in the air from Sam Bosworth, the 27-year-old Cox from the Avon Club. And if you're watching this in New Zealand, how sweet does that feel, guys?
So in my time as an elite athlete, I have raced in hundreds of races at the Olympic level. Hundreds of races. Hamish Bond has a famous history of being undefeated in the men's pair. He won 70 races in a row. I lost a similar amount of races in the men's eight and won one singular pinnacle event, and it was the Tokyo Olympics. Thank you.